Good morning. Good to see everybody here this morning. Sunday school class. If you've not seen him, we got a visitor with us this morning. He'll be rambling around. Our pastor's back with us. It's good to see him. Yeah, 2 weeks. That's fantastic. We'll go ahead and take up our prayer request this morning. Does anyone have a spoken request you want the class to pray about? Yes? Okay, let's remember Marilyn. Let's continue to pray for Brother Butch, who is home. Yes. Yeah. So we need to keep him in our prayers. Yes. Just remember this dire situation, yes. Others? Yes. Pray for our nation, yes. Other requests? Yes. Just remember this health issue, others? Unspoken requests? Girls? Traveling, yes. Just remember these that are traveling, yes. Let's join our hearts in prayer. Pray for service day as well. Let's all pray together. Most kind and gracious Heavenly Father, Lord, we just thank you, God, for another day that you've given us to come to your house to worship. Father, we thank you, Lord, for being with us this week, God, and keeping us, Lord, and each and everything that you've done for us, God, that we don't even realize, Father. And Lord, we ask, God, that you'd touch and minister to the needs here today, Lord. We pray for each one, each situation. God, those that are sick, Lord, that are battling illness, we pray for healing for their body. God, we pray for those that are traveling, that you'd be with them, Lord, and keep your hand upon them, bring them back safe. And Father, each unspoken request, I just pray that you'd move, Lord, minister to each situation. God, be with us in our service today, Lord. We pray your anointing upon each thing that is done here today, Lord. Let us be found worshiping you, Lord, in spirit and in truth, Lord. We ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. All right. Title of our lesson today is Marks of a True Disciple. Our central truth is disciples of Christ manifest Christ-like characteristics. Wow. So our introduction, when we become Christ's disciples, our life will begin to manifest characteristics that are Christ-like. An important truth stressed in today's lesson is that love is a catalyst for this transformation. We are unable to will ourselves into Christ's likeness. A deeper transformation must take place and continue taking place throughout our lives. The transformation begins when we first receive the saving love of God that is supremely manifested toward us through Jesus Christ. So Christian discipleship, we've been talking about, that's been our unit all week. This is our final lesson in that unit, and just thinking back about our lessons, you know, it's been like a building block, a building process, right? You think about our lessons, the first one, the call of discipleship. Sure, we have to be called, don't we? And in fact, that basic step that our introduction tells us about here, the transformation begins when we're saved, right? That's the first step of many steps. So another lesson talked about the cost of discipleship. Discipleship will cost you. But when you count the cost, it'll be worth it. We know that, don't we? And then the next lesson, I think, was entitled Upside Down Living. And I thought about that title, and I don't know if I really like that title or not, because, you know, when we're talking about upside down living, that's from the world's view. Because the living that we talked about in that lesson was right side up living. It was living, you know, according to Christ, according to the example of Jesus, right? So then last week we covered instructions for Christian discipleship. And we all need instructions, don't we? You know, we talked about that. When we're first saved, did we know everything we needed to know about the Bible and everything we needed to know how to live for God? No. And the apostles didn't either, because Jesus taught them. And he teaches us as well. And we're also, of course, through the Word, through the leading of the Holy Spirit, we learn and we grow. And that's That's what he's talking about here, a continual taking place in our lives, right? And in today's lesson, marks of a true discipleship, you're going to be marked. You're going to be marked by how you live. It's going to be a mark, going to be a sign upon you. So living this way that we're talking about, you're going to be marked as a true disciple of Christ. And that's what we want. That's what we want, isn't it? So let's go ahead and get into our lesson. It's going to come from the book of Galatians and then 1 John as well. So Galatians 5:16 through 18. This I say then, walk in the Spirit, and ye shall not fulfill the lust of the flesh. For the flesh lusteth against the Spirit against the flesh, and these are contrary the one to the other, so that ye cannot do the things that you would. But if you be led of the Spirit, you're not under the law. So one mark of true discipleship, according to Paul here, is what? To be led. Be led by the Spirit, right? And Paul lets us know, you know, what that means for us, because within the child of God, he talks about kind of like a tug of war, right? There's a war going on within us. And who or what are you going to listen to, right? Or it's the question, like, who's driving the car? And I always think about Brother Small, you know, he had certain pet peeves, you know, and one of his pet peeves was people that had a little sign on their car, you know, God is my co-pilot, right? Well, you know, we all know that God needs to be the pilot, right? So, yeah, so you know, he needs to be the driver. You know, who's driving the car? You can listen or you can follow the Holy Spirit and his guidance within you, or you can listen or follow the sinful nature or the flesh that Paul is writing about here. And we have that within us. What is that? What is flesh? It's just our human nature. You know, it's part of us, isn't it? It's desires or ambitions or ideas that pull us away from God, you know, the flesh. And 1 John 2:16, I think. Yeah. For all that is in the world, right? The lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life, it's not of the Father, but it's of the world. And so, you know, and Scripture tells us that, you know, now we're saved. When you're saved, you know, every sin that you've asked for forgiveness for and received forgiveness for is under the blood. But still, you know, Scripture tells us that we have to crucify the flesh daily that's within us. Now, you know, if we could control the flesh ourselves, then Paul would probably, you know, he'd write something different. You know, he would write something like, wrap that flesh up within you, you know, just contain it, set it over in the corner, don't touch it, don't look at it, hands off, it'll be all right. So that should work, shouldn't it? I don't know if it would or not. Let's think. We're intelligent living creations of God, and surely we can leave that alone, that flesh alone, if we set our mind to it. But then, you know, we remind ourselves of what happened in the garden, right? The Lord commanded a man, saying, of every tree of the garden thou mayest freely eat, but set this one aside. Don't touch it, but of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil thou shalt not eat of it. For the day that thou eatest of that, thou shalt surely die. So, yeah, I don't think we can deal with that flesh in our own strength. You know, maybe we think we can, and maybe we can for a little while, but when we leave it up to our own wisdom, I think we're ultimately, you know, we're gonna succumb, we're gonna fall to it, aren't we? Scripture tells us that as well. So if we try to walk in the Spirit by our own effort, you know, it's not gonna work. So these natural evil desires that he's talking about, the flesh, if you will. If we could, we'd try to control it ourselves, but we don't have to. That's what he tells us. We have within us the Spirit, the Holy Spirit, Holy Ghost. And as a child of God, we have that within us. And that's the war that's going on that he's talking about, two forces. And the thing of it is, they're not equal in power. We know that. The Holy Spirit can overcome the flesh if we will let it. Somebody somewhere either heard a sermon preached or read something somewhere. It's like within you there's two dogs fighting over a bone. So which one's going to win? The one you feed, right? You're going to feed the Spirit or you're going to feed the flesh? Whichever one you feed, that's the one that's going to have control. So make sure what? Be led by the Spirit. Pour into you things of God. What are you pouring into you during the week? What are you partaking in, right? So, that's some questions we need to ask ourselves and make sure that we're pouring into ourselves things of God so that the Spirit will be stronger than the flesh. So, walk in the Spirit, he said. Walk in the will of God. And that term walk, right, it's like our introduction told us. It means to be continual. It means to be habitual. In other words, make it a habit. Make it natural, right? Make it natural to walk in the Spirit, to walk in the will of God. We talk about bad habits a lot, don't we? Hey, I've got this bad habit or I've got that bad habit. Well, develop some good habits. And this is one good habit that we can develop to be led by the Spirit. Have a desire to pour into yourself the things of God, to hear the Word of God, to be obedient and listen to the Spirit, be discerning to the Spirit of God. Know the difference between the Spirit speaking to you and your flesh speaking to you. There's a difference there. We need to differentiate between that. Know there's a difference there. And listen to the Spirit. Make sure the Holy Spirit leads you and guides you. And we go on in Corinthians 19 through 21, Paul talks about the works of the flesh, and they're manifest in these: adultery, fornication, uncleanness, lasciviousness, adultery, witchcraft, hatred, variance, emulations, wrath, strife, seditions, heresies, envyings, murders, drunkenness, revelings, and such like. Of the which I tell you before, as I have also told you in time past, that they which do such things shall not inherit the kingdom of God. So he goes on, he identifies works, right? Works of the flesh. And we talked about, the title of our lesson, Marks of a True Disciple. Well, here's some marks of somebody that follows their own nature, right? Or follows any evil influence in this world. That's what they're marked by. They're marked by these lifestyles, and these are, when he talks about these works of the flesh, they're actually lifestyles. They're, you're engaging in this, and you're practicing this, right? He's not really talking about the occasional sin that we as children of God we're subject to, and we may fall sometime into make a mistake or, make an error, do the wrong thing. Well, that's, we can overcome that, but when you make it a lifestyle, then you're in trouble. Because what does he sum it up here by saying, you're not going to inherit the kingdom of God if you live that way. If that's going to be the way you live, you intentionally go about that way of living. Any comments here before we go on? Yeah. It's easy if you pour into yourself the right thing. And, you know, when you feed that part of you, right? And it does. It makes things a lot easier, a lot simpler for the child of God to live as we're supposed to live when we pour these things into us. And sometimes when you see somebody that's maybe not a happy Christian, I say a lot of it's due to, you know, what they poured into themselves, right? Anyone else? Okay, so go on. Verses 22 through 26. But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, goodness, faith, meekness, temperance. Against such there is no law. And they that are Christ have crucified the flesh with the affections and lusts. If we live in the Spirit, let us also walk in the Spirit. Let us not be desirous of vainglory, provoking one another, envying one another. So Paul listed, you know, works of the flesh. And now he contrasts these works of the flesh with the fruit of the Spirit. And notice, you know, works are what we do when we yield to the temptation of the flesh. But here, you know, fruit is produced in our lives when we're led by the Holy Ghost or Holy Spirit. It's a natural occurrence when we allow the Spirit to work in us. Fruit is produced. And so what exactly does that mean? You know, any born-again believer we know in Christ has within us the Holy Spirit. Romans 8:9, but ye are not in the flesh, child of God, he's talking to here, but in the Spirit, if so be that the Spirit of God dwell in you. Now, if any man have not the Spirit of Christ, he is none of his. So we have this. The Holy Spirit within us brings us to spiritual life. And if we will listen to that Spirit, he will lead us. He will guide us to a life of righteousness, a life of holiness. And that lifestyle will produce fruit. And it's a natural production of fruit that he talks about here, a natural result of having him within us. Boy, I put the wrong slide there, didn't I? There we go. All right. So it's a natural result. And that's what, you know, what's the title of our lesson? Marks of a True Disciple. Here we go. The bearing of fruit. Now, if we tend our spiritual orchard or our spiritual garden, you know, there's a natural production of fruit, but we can tend that garden, and what's going to happen? Production's going to go up, isn't it? So, and I think Scripture kind of goes along with that when it says we can produce fruit. We can produce more fruit. And we can produce, what was that other one? Fruit, more fruit, much fruit, right? So tend your garden. In other words, get rid of the impurities of this world or the bugs, you know, the things that will take away from your production of fruit. Fertilize your orchard, your spiritual orchard, your spiritual garden, by again pouring into you the things of God, the Word of God. And so there's fruit, more fruit, much fruit. And, you know, stay away from those sinful desires. Don't listen to those things. So, you know, fruit of the Spirit, we can take these and we can talk about them, you know, all lesson, right? They break them, they're broke down into to categories. You know, they talk about the first three deal with upward qualities, and the second three outward qualities, and the third three inward qualities, and all these things. But let's look at them just for a minute. And I don't think it's just by chance that the first fruit of the Spirit listed is love. Right? I think, love, agape love, love that God has placed within every one of his children, it's rooted in every one of these other fruit of the Spirit. You think about joy, it's love overflowing. And you think about peace, it's love and contentment. And you think about long suffering is love that's untiring. Think about gentleness. It's love that endures. Goodness is love in action. Faith, you can think about it as love on the battlefield. And meekness is as love that is just disciplined. And then the last one, temperance, is just, it's just like, love, in training, right? You're learning, you're taking all this in. And we can all be fruit inspectors. I know a lot of people, talk about that, right? Inspecting fruit, especially when you inspect other people's fruit. But I think we need to be real careful, make sure that if we're fruit inspectors, we need to inspect our own fruit, don't we? Yeah. Where can I bear fruit that I'm not bearing fruit? And where can I bear more fruit? And where can I bear much fruit in the kingdom of God? This is only fruit inspection I think we need to get involved in, I believe. So Paul concludes. And he talks about, walk, if we live in the Spirit, let us also, walk in the Spirit. And he, once again, encouraging everybody to live by the Spirit. Keep in step with the Spirit. So that made me think about, he's always thinking about stuff that happens, right? So growing up, and keep in mind we're talking about keeping in step here. Growing up, I know we all probably had this, maybe in grade school or whatever, somebody in your class that was a tattletale. And hopefully nobody here was one. But I had a person that was very intent on tattletaling, a girl. And got several calls to the office because this person, tattletaling on me. And so I kept that, and I thought, man. So you grow up, you get out of grade school, you go to high school, and go your separate way, but still there was, every time I saw that girl, the only thing I could think about, man, how many whippings did I get because of this girl. So graduation. So let's go to graduation. So what happened to graduation? Well, you you're going to line up, walk down, walk to the pomp and circumstance music or whatever. And back then it was like, the shortest people were first and then the tallest. So I was 6 foot, so I was one of the tallest. And, of course, this girl was a tall girl, right? So, of course, we when they paired us up, surely not. But yeah, okay. So she tells me, we're walking. So, now when we start, you walk with your right foot first. You step right foot first. walk down, you know, you walk all the way down the aisle and you go a separate way. Okay, sure, we practice, you know, you practice that, you know. I don't know how many, they practice that. They used to practice that a lot. I don't think they do it anymore, you know, just practice walking in. But anyway, so every time, you know, we start right foot first. And of course, you know what I did when actual graduation come, right? I am left-handed. So when people say, you know, right, you know, left-handed people, you know, it goes, well, that's left, right? So sure, yeah. When we started, you know, left foot first, you know, and all the way down, it was out of step. So, but saying all that, I thought about that, you know, we don't need to be out of step with the Spirit, do we, right? We need to be in step. Make sure you're in step with the Holy Spirit. And that's what Paul's talking about here. You know, you live in the Spirit, you walk in the Spirit. You know, walk step in step with the Spirit. And he goes on to say, you know what? If you live that way, you're going to get along with people. You're going to especially get along with your brothers and sisters in Christ. Let us not be desirous of vainglory, provoking one another, envying one another. You won't be that person looking for, you know, the win a popularity contest. You won't be that person that will have that conceited attitude which brings with it jealousy and hard feelings towards each other. Be marked with the fruit of the Spirit. And remember that first one, right? Especially love. And very clearly, this life that Paul says that disciples is to live can only be lived with the help of the Holy Spirit within us. We can't do it on our own. We're not supposed to do it on our own. Any comments here? Yeah. Pouring in, yeah. Yes, exactly. Yeah. Joel Osteen. Anybody watch him? Anybody? He always starts out with a joke. Holy cow! Did you all hear the joke this morning? Guy breaks into a house, and you know it's dark, and he's picked him up something. He's going to steal it, and all of a sudden this voice says, "You better be careful. Jesus is watching." And the guy's, you know, there's nobody there, and he turns his flashlight on. There's a parrot in the corner, and he says, "What did you say?" He said, "I said you better be careful. Jesus is watching." And the guy says, "What kind of owners?" Or what's your name, I guess is what he said. Well, my name's Moses, right? And he said, well, what kind of owner, you know, names his parrot Moses? And the parrot says, the same owner that named his 150-pound Rottweiler Jesus. I probably butchered it, but anyway, you got the gist of it, right? Yeah. Oh, boy. All right, so let's see. Let's go on. Here we go. When an individual needs to verify their identity, how are you marked? Disciple of Christ, you know, you're marked. And that's what he's talking about here. It takes more than just their word. You can't just talk about it, right? It must be demonstrated by documentary evidence. There's a driver's license or a passport. And that evidence is meant to prove that that person is who they claim to be. And in a similar way, if we claim to be disciples of Jesus, instead of just talking about it, we must bear the proper evidence, and that proper evidence, of course, is a spiritual fruit and a life that is governed by love for God and love for our neighbor. Okay, let's go on to, 1 John. 1 John 3, 1 through 3. Behold, what manner of love the Father hath bestowed upon us, that we should be called the sons of God. Therefore the world knoweth us not, because it knew him not. Beloved, now are we the sons of God, and it doth not yet appear what we shall be. But we know that when he shall appear, we shall be like him, for we shall see him as he is. And every man that hath this hope in him purifieth himself, even as he is pure. So I wish we could grab a hold of John's enthusiasm here as he writes this, kind of draw it into herself. I put a couple of other translations up here, especially verse 1. What marvelous love that the Father has extended to us. Just look at it. We're called children of God. That's who we really are. But that's also why the world doesn't recognize us or take us seriously, because it has no idea of who he is or what he is up to. And then Amplified, see what an incredible quality of love the Father has shown to us, that we would be permitted to be named and called and counted the children of God, and so we are. John is so excited here, and he has a right to be excited, right? Because what he has just told us here is really, it's an amazing thing, isn't it? That it's actually mind-blowing. If you had socks on and got a hold of it, it would probably knock your socks off, right? The magnificent demonstration of God's love for his creation. And that's you. And that love is so great, it's so great, that he calls you not just his creation, but he calls you his child. And what's even better, we call him Heavenly Father. How many of us, when we pray, I know I do sometimes when you start your prayer, Heavenly Father, Father in heaven. Boy, don't just go over that without thinking about it. He is your Heavenly Father. No wonder John's excited when he writes about it, right? The love that he has for us. And that's what John's reminding us of, that we're so loved. And then he goes on, he talks about in verse 2, he talks about, he gives us kind of a little bit of a glimpse into the future, doesn't he? See, I don't know exactly what the end result of this life is going to be, but one thing that I do know, I don't know what we're going to look like, but I do know we're going to look like him. Whatever state that is, we will be like him, for we shall see him as he is. And think about that. See, that's... that's part of the discipleship that we're talking about, right? That progression of that lifestyle. You know, as you live this lifestyle, you get closer and closer to God. And here at the end, when Jesus appears, we don't know what he's going to be like, but we know when that time comes that we're going to be like him, because that's the only way we're going to be able to see him. You know, we're going to be changed, of course. And John goes on to say, because of this hope we have within us, that we will be like him, we should live our life on this world so that it's a purifying life, right? Purifying ourselves, our lifestyle, again, just moves us closer and closer to God. And that's that ultimate goal that is set before every child of God. And it should, you know, it's a progression, it's a spiritual growth, And again, it's a lifestyle that will mark you as a true disciple. Any comments here? Yeah. Yeah. Inspect your own fruit. We can all use that reminder sometimes, I think, can't we? Let's see. Verses 4 through 10. Whosoever committeth sin transgresseth also the law, for sin is the transgression of the law, and you know that he was manifested to take away our sins, in him is no sin. Where whosoever abideth in him sinneth not, whosoever sinneth hath not seen him, neither know him. Little children, let no man deceive you. He that doth righteousness is righteous, even as he is righteous. He that committeth sin is of the devil, for the devil sinneth from the beginning. And it's for this purpose that the Son of God was manifested, right? That he might destroy the works of the devil. Whosoever is born of God doth not commit sin, for his seed remaineth in him, and he cannot sin because he is born of God. In this the children of God are manifest, and the children of the devil. Whosoever doeth not righteousness is not of God, neither he that loveth not his brother. So, you know, looking here, you know, simply stated, what the children of God, our life cannot be characterized by a sinful lifestyle. You know, we talked about that a little bit earlier, right? The best advice John gave was in the previous chapter, in chapter 2, when he says, little children, sin not. But then he went on to say, but if you do sin, you know, you have somebody you can call upon. You have an advocate you can go to and can take care of that, you know, get it under the blood. And here he talks about, again, a lifestyle, or, you know, a habitual lifestyle of sin, of just living that lifestyle. And he says, you're the child of God. You know, you can't, it can't be. You can't live that way. You have to live a life of holiness, because that's what the Spirit will lead you to do when you listen to him. And that's, again, the mark of a disciple. And he goes on and says, let no man deceive you. You know, some in those days were saying, you know, that when you receive forgiveness, you receive forgiveness for past and present and future sins, and you could live any way you wanted to. And John says, no, you know, that's not it's not what God wants. You know, he wants a lifestyle of holiness, you know, a character that reflects Christ. Be Christ-like more and more every day. So again, you know, grow and keep gathering in, you know, what you can. And then Peter, you know, 1 Peter 1, 14 through 16, if I can find it here, there it is. As obedient children, not fashioning yourselves according to the former lusts in your ignorance, not living the way you lived before you were saved, but as he which hath called you is holy, so be ye holy in all manner of conversation. We know conversation's our lifestyle, right? Because it is written, be ye holy, for I am holy. You know, live that way and not take up that sinful lifestyle. Verses 7 through 11. Beloved, let us love one another, for love is of God, and everyone that loveth is born of God and knoweth God. He that loveth not knoweth not God, for God is love. In this was manifested the love of God toward us, because that God sent his only begotten Son into the world that we might live through him. Herein is love, not that we love God, but that he loved us. He sent his son to be the propitiation for our sins. Beloved, if God so loved us, we ought also to love one another. I think John's still reveling in that idea, you know, of Heavenly Father, and I'm a child of God, and here, you know, in chapter 4 here, you know, God is, you know, he says God is love. It's his very essence. It's his character, and it's what moves him, what moved him to create us, and it's what moves him toward his creation or toward us. And we are to love one another because we know God. If we do not love, we know not God. So a disciple of Christ, again, is marked what? He's marked by love. He's marked by his love for his brother and sister in Christ and his love for each other. And we do that, you know, again, knowing that he loved us even when we were unlovable, and he displayed his love for us. How? By what he did. He gave his best, the best he had in heaven. Jesus, you know, willingly gave himself, sacrifice for our sins. So, you know, you talk about, you know, a person may, you know about God or know about his love, but that's not enough. It's to experience it. Experience it when we have that relationship with him. And when we have that relationship with him, then that love comes down and engulfs, overflows us to give out the love of God. You've had to receive it. We worn this verse out, but I'm going to give it to you one more time. Romans 5:5. We probably had it never less than this unit, right? And hope maketh not ashamed, because the love of God for the child of God is shed abroad in our hearts by the Holy Ghost, which is given unto us. That Spirit of God that we have living within us, that love of God, it's just a conduit. It just comes in. And as it comes in, you know, that's what, you know, that's what we're to naturally give out as a child of God. You know, it's just natural as producing fruit, is to have that love overflow and pour out of us. First John 4, several verses here, but I really want to get to verse 17, 18. Herein is our love made perfect, that we may have boldness in the day of judgment, because as he is, so are we in this world. There is no fear in love, but perfect love casteth out fear, because fear hath torment. He that feareth is not made perfect in love. We love him, again, because he first loved us. So, you know, we know that God, you know, dwells within us by the Holy Spirit. And John writes here that the perfection or the completion of God's love in us is that removal of fear. Fear of what? Fear of the condemnation of sin. His love assures you, it should assure you, and assures me that you know, as a child of God, my sins are forgiven. We're saved from sinful living. God did that for Christ's sake, and now I pour into the Spirit that is within me, and I live a Christ-like life, and I grow into that each and every day. And if I stumble, I've got an advocate. You have an advocate. You know, you don't have to stop. You get that under the blood, and then you keep pressing forward. That's the mark of a true disciple. That's what marks you, makes you different from the world. We're supposed to be, aren't we? Supposed to be different from the world. As disciples of Christ, we're to live Christ-like, but then make sure it's governed by the love of God, right? Looks like our time's about gone. We appreciate your comments this morning, your attention.
Welcome this morning. I want to welcome everybody. Got a beautiful, beautiful spring day to worship the Lord. Of course, any day is a good day to worship the Lord. And the good Sarah Pastor back with us. Yeah. We've missed him, haven't we?
Yes.
We do. We're just glad to have each one. And Randy, where's your brother? I wanted him to welcome him. And glad to have him with us. Okay, glad to have him with us, and glad to have Lena's grandchildren with us, and Sister Gladys, glad to see her been able to be here this morning. We do want to welcome each one of you, want to welcome all of our visitors, and just glad you're here, expecting good things. Brother Bill is, Dunbar will be bringing the message a little later, and he always does such a good job, and we're just glad for him filling in, and we are about to. We just want to welcome each one here. I had a wonderful men's breakfast yesterday. Had a good crowd. Brother Jim, I thought, done an outstanding job, and he done a devotion. And if any of the men ain't come, you need to come and try it. We have a really good breakfast. They always fix a good breakfast, and we've had several visitors that comes. We had a good time. Also, Easter coming up a couple of weeks. We're gonna, of course, y'all's always really good to bring plenty of eggs for the kids, and you know, we're expecting that again, so be getting ready for it. It's in 2 weeks, so we're going to have a good spring. Okay, let's all stand. We'll get started this morning. We'll ask Jeff and Lyon to come and lead us in some songs, and we'll just get into the Lord.
It's good to see everybody here this morning to worship the Lord. Let's help us sing, I want my Lord to be satisfied with me.
Years.
That's one song that never gets old, Amazing Grace. That's a special, special song. I'm going to take up our prayer request this morning. And of course, we'll continue to remember Brother Butch and just continue to hold him up in prayer that he can get back with us. Any other requests? Okay, remember Sister Merlin. Okay. Others? Okay, remember Josh. Joshua. Okay, remember him. Okay. Others this morning? Okay. Any others? Okay, remember him. Okay. Okay, yeah. Remember Sister Jenny, yes. Continue to hold Sister Maud up in prayer. Okay. Others, woman. Okay. Can us all stand and just take your request before the Lord? Lord, we come to you this morning so thankful. Lord, once again, be in your house. To be in your presence, to be called a child of God. Lord, what an honor that is. Lord, we're so thankful, Lord. We can never praise you enough. Lift you up, Lord, for the many prayers you've answered in our lives. Lord, we come to you on behalf of these precious requests, Lord. And Lord, we continue to pray for Brother Bush, Lord. Lord, we pray for Sister Merlin, Lord, to touch her knees. Lord, touch you with a healing, Lord, we pray. And Lord, we pray for Sister Maud, Lord. We today pray for Sister Peggy, grandson Joshua. Lord, you know what the need is. You know what needs to be done. Lord, we just pray that you would just be them. And Lord, we pray for Sister Jasmine West. Pray for that one. Lord, we pray for Sister Jenny. Lord, she's been such a prayer warrior for this church for many years. Now, Lord, we lift her up to glory. Lord, touch her body, Lord, that she can breathe easier. Lord, we pray for a man in the prayer. Lord, just help her. You'll get well, Lord. Lord, continue to pray for her faith. Lord, just continue to strengthen and help me. Lord, we pray for the servant. We pray for souls. We pray for salvation this morning. Lord, as Brother Bill brings her message later, Lord, we pray that souls be convicted. Pray for her saints, each one that has a heart. Lord, we just ask this thing in Jesus' precious name. Praise God. Take up our tithe and offering this morning. Brother Keith, would you come up and pray the blessing over the offering?
Let us pray. Lord, it's good to be back in the house. Good to feel your presence and your spirit, Lord, through the Sunday school hour and the songs, Lord, that continue to bless. Thank you for the group of people that's assembled here today and being so faithful to hearing and answering our prayers. Now, Lord, we ask that you bless this offering, bless those that bring it, Lord, and meet the needs, Lord, of the people that give and can't give. Meet the needs of this church, Lord, that it continues to grow and prosper, that souls would be saved and brought into the kingdom. We pray this in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Start special singing, and Brother Doug, where's Kevin? You'll sing first, then Brother Doug. That'll work.
I can never thank the Lord for his blessings on me enough. Brother Matt sung this song 2 or 3 weeks ago, but it's one of my favorites. Thank you, Lord, for your blessings on me. You all help me. As the world looks upon me, as I struggle along, they say I have nothing, but they are so wrong. In my heart, there's rejoicing. How I wish they could see. Thank you, Lord, for your blessings on me. There's a roof up above me. I've a good place to sleep. There's food on my table and shoes on my feet. You gave me your love, Lord, and a fine family. Thank you, Lord, for your blessings on me. Well, you know I'm not wealthy, and these clothes, they're not new. I don't have much money, but Lord, I have you. And to me, that's all that matters, though the world may not see. Thank you, Lord, for your blessings on me. There's a roof up above me. I've a good place to sleep. There's food on my table and shoes on my feet. You gave me your love, Lord, and a fine family. Thank you, Lord, for your your blessings on me. There's a roof up above me, I've a good place to sleep. There's food on our tables and shoes on our feet. You gave me your love, Lord, and a fine family. Thank you, Lord, for your blessings on me.
Well, there's a man in here who turns water to wine, and he walks on the water and gives sight to the blind, and he gives back life to the ones instead, and he fed 4,000 with 7 loaves of bread. And there's a man in here who makes demons flee, who makes cripples walk, and he's chosen even me. Now he lives down in my heart, and I'll have no fear. I'm a better man, 'cause there's a man in here. There's a man in here I'm a-looking for, cried a man who could find no room at the door. And so they lowered him down on a stretcher bed, and then Jesus looked at him and said, all your sins are all now gone this day. Just take up your bed and go your way. And as he walked through the crowd, they heard him declare, I can tell you all that there's a man in there. 'Cause there's a man in here who turns water to wine, and he walks on the water and gives sight to the blind, and he gives back life to the ones that's dead. And he fed 4,000 7 loaves of bread. And there's a man in here who makes demons flee, who makes cripples walk, and he's chosen even me. Now he lives down in my heart, I'll have no fear. And there's a better man, 'cause there's a man in here. All right, Josh. There's a man in here, the disciples, they cried when the ship was tossed from side to side. So they woke him up as the waves blew high and said, hey, don't you care that we're about to die? And he said, peace be still. And when the wind had laid, he said, where's your faith? Why are you so afraid? And then they saw that the sea had turned smooth and clear. They said, thank you, God, that the man's in here. 'Cause there's a man in here who turns water to wine, and he walks on the water and gives sight to the blind, and he gives back life to the ones instead. And he fed 4,000 with 7 loaves of bread. And there's a in my heart. I'll have no fear, cause I'm a better man, cause there's a man in here. Hey, I'm a better man, cause there's a man in here.
Lord is really here, isn't it? And just get behind Brother Bailey as he brings a message, and I believe it's going to be a God-sent message this morning.
Sister Jenny, would you just stay just a moment? Would you stay just a moment? We can preach at any time.
Yes.
But there's a special time. And I don't want to start preaching until I give the Holy Ghost some more time. Could we just stand again? There's nothing more important than somebody being saved in this house. That's the most important thing. I can preach any time. But I want to open this all to the Holy Ghost has invited you. A pleading, there was a pleading here in the Spirit this morning. And you heard the voice of the Holy Ghost. You felt that tugging on your innermost being. And you've got a choice to make this morning. You'll make a choice either way. Don't make the wrong one. Don't make the wrong one. Please come today. This church will gather around you. No, I don't know how many there are. I don't know if there's just one or several. I don't know that. But I know that these people will gather around you, welcome you, pray with you, bless you. Why don't you come today? It's not just by chance that you're here this morning. There may have been different channels that got you here this morning. But the Holy Ghost was the drawing card. He was the drawing card that brought you into this congregation this morning. Pilate asked a question to people who wanted to Barabbas. He said, what will you then do with Jesus? I'm asking you that question this morning. What are you going to do with Jesus this morning? You're either going to receive him or you're going to turn him away. Just take that first step. Whoever or however many this morning, this is the most important thing. I've heard some of the best music this morning singing I've ever heard. That was wonderful. Set the tone for what's going on right now. But I'm telling you, what's going on right now is the most important thing that's going on. Because there is a soul or souls that are weighing in the balance this morning. What will you do with Jesus? What will you do with Jesus? Church, I want to ask us all just to pray again. Father, at a time like this, it's very difficult to go on with maybe what we as individuals had planned, what man, so to speak, had planned this morning. Because we believe, Lord, that you've got a better plan. That you've got a better plan this morning. And I stand before you this morning, Lord, needing, Lord, your guidance, needing your wisdom, Lord, and praying, God, that the Holy Ghost, your Holy Spirit, will draw with your magnetic drawing power, Lord, someone to this altar. However many, Lord, I pray, God, that no one would leave here lost and undone today. I pray when this building empties today, Lord, there's not a sinner leaving. There's not a one leaving, God, that's not ready to meet you. As you keep praying, church, I want to extend the invitation, if that's okay, Pastor. I want to do that one more time. Why don't you come today? Oh, thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord, for what you're doing. There's others. There's others. There's others. What you need to do is come here and lay it all down to Jesus. Like I did almost 43 years ago, the old white church across the street over here. Would you come? Would you come? I just feel like there's more. I feel like there's... Would you come? Don't let this opportunity slip through your fingers. Would you come today? Jesus, Jesus, Holy Spirit of Almighty God. What will you do with Jesus? It's not what he will do. We know what he'll do for you. He'll save you. He'll receive you. We know that. The question is, what will you do with him this morning? Would you turn him away? Or will you allow him? In his mercy and his grace, oh, how gracious he is, to restore you to the joy of your salvation, to restore you back into the fold. Don't turn him away. There's somebody back there who will walk up here with you. If you'll just reach and take somebody's hand that's standing close to you, they'll walk up here with you. Will you surrender all this morning? All to thee, my blessed Savior. I surrender all. Would that be what you'd do this morning? Play it through one more time, Sister Jenny. Would you come? One more time, would you come? You may be seated. Throughout the remainder of this service, I want you to keep praying. I want you to keep praying. Let's don't let the enemy win this one. I realize it's up to a personal choice. I understand that. But I believe many times our prayers can change those things. I believe that with all my heart. What an honor to see this man back with us this morning. I don't have a text this morning, but I have a title. Usually I have a title and a text. I have known of people, done it myself a time or two, when I've had a title and text and never did get around to reading it because I just took off preaching. I've heard it when people didn't have one, they still took off preaching. Main thing is the Holy Ghost touches us after we get up here. Because there ain't nothing we can do in ourselves without the Spirit of God. I have a title without a text, but many scriptures I'll share with you that you can pick out which one would have been your text if you were doing this. The title of my message this morning is The Message of Life. The message of life is Jesus Christ. That's the message. He's God's love letter. He's the Word of God. And He's God's love letter sent to us. The message of life is Jesus Christ. He is life. In John alone, we have many scriptures. And you could probably find one, and I could have found plenty here that I could have used for the text. But in John alone, we have many scriptures. I want to share some of those with you as I begin my message this morning. In John, I'm talking about St. John, chapter 1, verse 4. He said, "In Him was life, and the life was the light of men." Now, the rest of them are going to be red letter ones that Jesus spoke in the book of St. John. He said in 3:16, you know it, "For God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in Him should not perish, but have everlasting life." In John 6:63, He said, "It is the Spirit that quickeneth, the flesh profiteth nothing." The words that I speak unto you, they are spirit and they are life. I'm talking about the Word of God. I'm talking about what is spirit and they are life. And I could just stop there just for a minute, because John 6:63 was in the middle of His discourse on the bread of life. And back starting about verse somewhere 50 through 53, He started telling the people that was listening to Him. He had just fed earlier in this chapter. He had just fed the 5,000, and the people who listened to Him, He said, "Except you eat My flesh and drink My blood, you have no life in you." Now, He's not talking about something literal. He's talking about something spiritual. "Except you partake of Me, except you partake of all of Me, eat My flesh and drink My blood, you have no life in you." And so I kind of stopped there at verse 63, they've got some of my scriptures back there, and I told them there'll be some that I'm always writing, always up to the last time God is speaking to me in the wee hours of the morning, and I'm writing things down. And so I thought about the verse that comes after that, verse 63, and the first part of the verse 64, Jesus said that there be some among you, there are some of you that believe not. That was the first part of a rather long verse. And let's jump over to verse 66, because it says, "From that time forth, many went back and walked no more with Him." In verse 67, it said, "Then Jesus said unto the 12, Will you also go away?" And I believe I did give them verse 68. It said that, "Then Simon Peter answered to Him and said, Lord, to whom shall we go? Thou hast the words of eternal life." I believe when the Holy Ghost spoke this morning that He gave words of eternal life. He gave an opportunity for eternal life. I believe that He's still with us right now. You never know what's going to happen when you first get up here. There's always that thing, and I'm always walking in faith, just trusting God, saying, "God, sometimes I don't feel nothing. Sometimes I feel cold as a wedge when I step here. But then something starts happening." You know what I'm talking about, preacher. You know what I'm talking about. I know Keith knows what I'm talking about. Several of you people know what I'm talking about. Then something else just comes in and takes over. And it's something supernatural. It's something that you and I, if we tried to control it, we'd fall on our face. If we tried to take this thing, it's too big for us, because it's the power of Almighty God stretching way beyond my imagination and what God can do. And so I'm just giving you some scriptures on life. In John 10 and 10, we're still in the red letters here. The thief cometh not but to steal, kill, and destroy. I have come, Jesus said, that you may have life and have it more abundant. That's what I'm talking about this morning. I'm talking about abundant life. I'm not talking about just natural life. I'm talking about something that gets a hold of you when the Holy Ghost comes on you. That's what I'm talking about this morning. In John 11 and 25, Jesus said, I am the resurrection and the life. There's life. You see the word life in all these scriptures. I am the resurrection and the life. He that believeth on me, though he were dead, yet shall he live. You can still live this resurrection power. I'm glad we still got it. Then one more in John's gospel, John 14 and 6. Jesus saith unto them, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh to the Father but by me. There was a way laid out this morning. There was a way laid out, and that was through Jesus and the Holy Spirit's wooing. And I'm praying that that way will stay that way throughout this service. My God, saints, I know you're praying now, but I want you to keep praying. I want you to keep praying. The most important thing that can take place this morning is the one or the two or ever how many that did not respond to the call of the Holy Ghost. The most important thing is that be extended. And I know God's a merciful God. I know He is. I can't say nothing past each service. But I can't believe that in the middle of a service like this, with His power like it was, I don't believe He's taking it back. I don't believe He's withdrawing anything. God wants to see the kingdom filled. He wants to see everyone in the kingdom. He wants us all. It's not His will that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance, the Word of God says. He's the message of life. In Philippians 1 and 21, Paul said, for to me to live is Christ, and to die is gain. Now, you may think I'm splitting hairs here, because a lot of people, they quote that and they leave out that first preposition too. They just say, for me to live is Christ, and to die is gain. But I'm telling you, when he puts that first preposition to, when he says, for to me, Paul said, I'm taking ownership of this thing. This is my opinion, and this is what I'm going, for to me to live is Christ, and to die is gain. I'm telling you, It was on February the 17th, I believe, in 1980, over at the old white church. Just over 42 years ago that the Holy Ghost spoke one night. Some of you people may have been in the service. I don't know if you were. There's a lot of people here now that weren't coming in. There's a lot of those dear old saints that were there. They're already shouting on the hills of glory, and including my mom and some of your moms and some of your relatives. They're already up there. They're already partaking of this thing. But it was February the 17th, 1980, the Holy Ghost spoke. And funny thing, my mom and them women had been back there in the back praying before service. You know how they do that. They'd be back in the back praying, and I'm on the back seat. I was under conviction so bad I went to church that morning. I can tell you why it was so strong that I chose not to partake that afternoon after I got home from church. We'd always leave after Sunday school because we didn't want to stay around. The Holy Ghost got moving. You know how that was. And we'd leave after Sunday school, and I chose not to put anything in my body, any mind-altering substance. It was on me that strong. I was afraid if I did, I'd lose that conviction. I went back that night. It was a cold night. It was an old snowy night. But I came back over there, and my mom come out of that. She came out of that room, them women did before service, and I'm on the back seat. I'm miserable as I can be. My mom was not a forward. I mean, she was strong in the Holy Ghost, but she was a saint. I mean, she was precious. And what are you going to do? I'm going to say, no. Man, I'd have been scared to say no to my mama. I would have been scared to say. And I go up there, and she said, Dad, I can't remember if it was the second or third bench that she said home. She said, same place, but all the time. And I went and sat down by her. Brother Stacy and them were still in the choir. I think he was leading the choir, and Sister Adriel, I believe, was playing the piano, if I remember correctly. And the Holy Ghost spoke. Sister Jo Stevens might have been sitting there beside Mom. And the Holy Ghost spoke. And it gave this invitation. It was an old, cold, snowy night, and everybody knew I was the only sinner in the building. You couldn't even fake it, you know. You couldn't even fake it. Wasn't very many people there. And I just sat there. My mom interpreted the message. And the Holy Ghost spoke again. And my mom interpreted the message. And Brother Stacy said, I'm going to do something I've never done in all my life. As a pastor, he said, I've never given an invitation without preaching. He said, but I'm going to give an invitation. I didn't mean to bring all this out. This has just come on me. I just reached and got my mom's hand. And I've never regretted it. Never, ever regretted it. 42 years. God may give me a half a century. He may give me more than that. Who knows? Who knows how long he may give me on this earth. But I can tell you there's not been anything. There's not been anything like it. I ain't saying in pastoring for pastoring for 39 years and 7 months total. I ain't saying there's not been some things that hadn't been pleasant. There have been some of those things, but for the most part, the grace and glory and mercy of God has been on me. I've not had a lot of problems that other people have had. God's just always been good to me. We had to work through some things anybody as a pastor does, but I can tell you that I have lived for God for almost 42, well, a little over 42 years now, and that is without any regrets whatsoever, because I don't think. I believe if I hadn't responded to it, right, I believe, I don't know this, nobody knows, I believe I was getting my last call. I knew better. I'd forsaken God. I'd forsaken my upbringing. I'd done all other things, but God, in His mercy, came back and was loved me enough. And loved me enough that the message came out a second time. But Mom, when I reached and got my hand, I think at first she thought I may have been going to leave or something, and was just squeezing her hand, because there was something you just feel like that there was like a fear went through Mama. But no, I wasn't turning loose. I said, we're going up here now. And I just want to tell you what, and I thank all of you, most of you probably are new people since that time, but I want to thank the ones that did pray for me. There may be some of you here besides my sister and maybe a few of the rest of you that were there that night. I don't know. I can't remember everything. But I know that that was an important time in my life, the most important time ever in my life. And we're not going to get anywhere. I ain't even got to my thesis statement yet. I'm not even made my main thing I want to say yet. But He is the message of life. In Philippians 4:13, Paul said, I can do all things through Christ, which strengtheneth me. In John 15:5, Jesus said, I am the vine, ye are the branches. He that abideth in me and I in him, the same bringeth forth much fruit. For without me, you can do zero. Without me, you can do nothing. I can't do anything without him. How many times, and I know, preacher, I know he's a preaching machine, but I know that there's sometimes you walked up there like that and you didn't know what was going to happen. You had prepared yourself, you had prayed, you had studied, and you didn't know. But God never did let you down when you prepared yourself. He never did let you down. He never lets us down when we go before Him humbly and say, God, I know I can't do this without you. I can't make it without you. Oh, when we get to that place, and I'm telling you, the older I get, the more I feel like that too. There's years start to creep up on you now. I'm just a young 68 and heading 69. Feel like a young mule. I feel pretty good for that. I tell you I do. And so I want to keep this thing going as long as I can. But I also know heaven ain't second best to nothing. And I'm not in any hurry to go, to tell you the truth, till God calls us home. But if He wants to call me home before He calls us all home, then that'll be all right too. And so I just want to thank God and thank you, dear people, for the prayers that are coming up this way. He is the message of life as Christ the written word and Christ the living word. Like I said, He's God's love letter. God mailed Him to us in the New Testament and gave us all these things. So in this message, I will try to limit myself if I can this morning. But I want to depict our lives within the message of life. What I'm saying is our lives in Christ, because the message of life is Christ. That's Jesus Christ. And so what I'm going to do so is by pointing out the individual words within the word message. I called it the message of life. I've never done a message like this before. Actually, I taught at the small group settings on a couple of occasions, probably some 20 years ago, when this came to me. But I want to try to preach it today. I taught it. I want to try to preach it today. So you stay with me. Danny's going to put the words up there, and I've had him to emphasize them in a certain way. But the first word in the word message is me. That's the first word in the word message is me. Who the message speaks to first is me. That includes you, which, as if you're reading it, okay? I'm talking about just me. The one that the message speaks to first, when I am reading it, when I'm praying and he's talking to me, it's me. This message is personal to me. He's personal to you. Ain't you God that we've got a one-on-one God? He's personal to you. He cares about you. He loves you. And he wants to keep it personal with you. So the first to be encouraged is me. But the first to be rebuked is also me. And I know when I get in this book, it looks back at me and rebukes me. There's some time, if it didn't, I would. I don't know if I'd read it or not. If it didn't, I guess we'd think we had it all figured out. And I'm telling you that 42 years and ever how many days that is, and I don't think I've missed a day reading the scriptures. I decided I was going to have the bread of life, and I was going to put it in me every day. I wasn't going to try to get by a day without it. There's been some days I haven't got as many days as I did in other times, or as many hours, as much time in. But I try to meet the Lord early in the morning, every morning, down in my I call it my prayer closet. It's my entire basement. I've got all the amenities I need. I've got when I bought the house, I think they called it a wet bar. I call it my coffee bar, but they called it a wet bar. I've got all that down there. I've got full bath. I've got all the amenities that I can go down there, and if Ann don't need me, she won't disturb me. She knows she can disturb me anytime she wants to. That's fine, but I've got time. I want to spend that time. I don't know how much time I've got left here, but I know when I've got time, I want to spend it with him. And again, I'm just now getting into some things I meant to say this morning. But as I depict the message of life and what each word, the words that I got to come with me on this. So the first to be encouraged is me. The first to be rebuked is me. Now, the second word I see in the word message is mess. Now, I've got to be transparent first. I don't want to hinder my anointing if I'm not. I've got to be candid with you. I've got 5 different words that I saw in the word message. And you know what the last one I saw was? Me. The one that's first. The first. Isn't that funny? Sometimes we see everything but ourselves. We see what everybody else is doing wrong but ourselves. But I'm telling you, me can make a mess out of things. And sometimes I just feel like I need to be transparent with you and let you all know that was the last word I noticed. I had me 4 points. I had me 4 words. And it's kind of like that little voice within, like, hey, look again. You sure that's all of them? And I looked again, and the most important one, I guess, was me, because I was the one that needed the most instruction from God. So sometimes life can turn into a mess. Many times made because of me. In your case, you put the me there. We bring it on ourselves sometimes. Sometimes after accepting the message of life, Jesus Christ, God's love letter into our lives, life becomes a mess. It just happens. That's the way it is sometimes as we serve God. There's just things come along that we would rather we didn't have to put up with. I wish I could just make it pie in the sky and a sweet pie and buy all those things that some of these preachers try to make it to be. You know, they just make it like there's never any problems. But the Bible says, many are the afflictions of the righteousness, but the Lord's delivered him out of them all. There's those things that we go through, and it just happens that way. Many are the afflictions of the righteous. Sometimes, after accepting the message of life, life becomes a mess. Oh, it's so good we accept it. Everything is so wonderful then. But then, along the way somewhere, probably pretty soon after, we know we don't like to give the devil any credit, but we also aren't ignorant of his ways either. We know what he tries to do. Sometimes it's because of our own selves that life becomes a mess. And sometimes it's because of others that life becomes a mess. Let's just look at David, one of my favorite characters in Scripture. What a mess he was. What a mess. This man after God's own heart, what a mess he was. Now, when he was dodging Saul's javelin, when Saul was throwing that javelin at him, trying to kill him, that wasn't brought on by himself. That was brought on by Saul's jealousy because that David had slain his 10,000s and Saul had just slain his 1,000s. And the women folk, and the women were pretty probably supposed to, back in those days, supposed to walk about eight. Oh, you've come a long way, baby. They're supposed to walk about 8 paces behind their husband. I forget how many going down the street. That was just in biblical times that they were looked on more or less as chattel. I didn't say cattle. As chattel, as property, as property. And so the women, I don't want to stay on this too long, but sometimes other things cause these things to take place in their life. And so David, that wasn't his fault there. Neither was when he was hiding in a cave trying to hide out from Saul and Saul trying to take his life. That wasn't David's fault. That mess didn't take place because of David, but that was also because of the jealous spirit that had come on Saul. The Bible said the anointing came upon David and the spirit left Saul. That all happened just within a verse or two there, and I believe in 1 Samuel 15, the anointing came on David, and the Spirit left Saul. God had put his anointing on Saul. He had anointed him to be king. He had God's anointing. If he'd flew right, if he'd done what he was supposed to do, it would have stayed on Saul, but God took it from him and put it on a man after his own heart. Now, let's look at another mess David got into. That was that mess in that adulterous affair that he got in with Bathsheba. That wasn't anybody's fault but David himself. He went from the rooftop to the bedtop. He made a bad mistake. He was looking down and he saw this beautiful woman. And I've read who the five most beautiful women ever. Now, I don't know how they figure this out. But in the world, and she's one of them. She's one of them. It's listed as the five most beautiful women. Esther, I believe, was one of them. I can't remember all five of them, but she was one of them. And he looked down one day. But you know what? Where it really started at in the first chapter, in the first verse of chapter 11 of 2 Samuel, it said, "And when the times that the kings went forth to battle," he was a king. But he sent Joab. Joab was just the general of his army. So he was a king. And he was supposed, there was a time that he was supposed to go. So he stayed behind. He went against God's will. They were supposed to go forth at a certain time to battle. That's the first thing that'll get us in trouble. If we get out of God's will, it may seem just like a little thing at times. But I'm telling you what, if we don't get back, and we all get out there occasionally, there's none of us perfect. We step out of it here and there. We probably don't obey God if he says to go see somebody, go talk to somebody or whatever, anything like that. We all miss God sometimes. We push him to the limit sometimes. But I'm telling you that his mess caused a lot of problems, this mess that David brought on himself. It was caused by himself. Now I need to get off of this point. Jonah's mess was caused by Jonah himself. Jonah brought that mess on him. He was the one when God said, "You need to go to Nineveh," and he chose to go to Tarshish, and the commentary I read says that was 180 degree direction. It was directly opposite. Tarshish was directly opposite from Nineveh. He turned and went exactly that. He brought that mess on himself. And now Job's mess that came on him, that wasn't Job's fault. That was because of his three self-righteous. Well, first of all, God let the devil loose on him just to prove to the devil that Job would stand for him. So God allowed that to happen. But then there was those three self-righteous friends of his, and that's what made a mess out of his life. So that the second word I see in the word message is mess. Thirdly, the third word I see in the word message is sag, S-A-G. In times of life's messes, our spirits begin to sag at times. Our faith sags also. When our spirits begin to sag, our faith begins to sag also. When these messes come along that we have not yet got cleaned up or have not yet been able to get out of, they happen. Now, David was in a cave, and David was so down that he said, "No man cared for my soul." I could read it to you in Psalm 140. 42, verse 4, and then I want to bring it verse 5, because I never noticed verse 5 that much till this week. But he said in verse 4, Psalm 142, I looked on my right hand and beheld, and there was no man that would know me. They wouldn't even acknowledge him, is what he is saying. He said, refuge fail me. No man cared for myself. No man would even give him the time of the day. No man would acknowledge him, and no man cared. Boy, that's a bad place to be. No man cared for my soul. Oh, but old David, it took more than that to stop David. He said in verse 5, I cried unto thee, O Lord. I said, thou art my refuge and my portion in the land of the living. David knew how to get back. He knew how to get back in God's good graces. He knew what he needed to do. Oh, God, raise up some Davids among all of us. Raise up some Davids to say, I ain't going back. I'm going forward. I'm going to serve God come what may. Oh, I'm going to be after his own heart. I'd like David. Let's all make that decision in our lives today and every day of our lives. Now, First Samuel 30 and 6. They spoke of stoning. They spoke of stoning David. That was something that was caused by others too. That wasn't caused by David. The Bible said that he was distressed. I'll get back to this in just a minute in another area. In 1 Samuel 30, verse 6. But what I want to talk about is something that happened when he went from the rooftop to the bedtop. Because then, in Psalm 51, is that confession prayer of David. Oh, what a prayer it is. What a great prayer it is of David when he cried out to God, against thee, thee only have I sinned. Oh, he wasn't putting on in. He was serious. He knew he had tasted the best there was to taste, and he wanted to get back to it. He wanted to get back to it again. And so in Psalm 51, verse 10, he said, renew a right spirit within me. In verse 11, he said, take not thy Holy Spirit from me. In verse 12, he said, restore unto me the joy of thy salvation. Oh, have you been to those times when it had been dragging just a little bit, when it didn't always feel as good as it had at other times, but then the joy of that salvation was restored? My God, sometimes I get in my prayer closet. Remember, it's a 28 and a half by 30, or a 30 and a half, but however, it's almost a square my basement office is. And can you just imagine what takes place sometimes when the Holy Ghost comes on me? My wife would probably panic if she do all the things, but so it's just me and God, and I love being alone in his presence, walking with him. So Jonah, he brought his, and I told you earlier, he brought it on himself. I'm using some of these in two or three of these different points. And in his affliction, down on the bottom of the ocean, in the belly of the whale, seaweed all around his head. I would say this was a cold hell. I don't know if it, but he said, out of the belly of hell cried I. That's what Jonah said. He was talking about his situation. He said, out of the belly of hell cried I. I don't know if God would have made it warm in that whale's belly. God could have done whatever he wanted to do if it did. But I know that Jonah felt like he was going through hell. Let me tell you something. If you're outside of the grace of Christ, all you've got to do is step into it. It's available to you. If you're without, if you're not within Jesus, and if you don't have Jesus in your life, I pray, God, that you would. I pray that's the most important thing that can take place, is getting saved. I loved it 6 weeks later when I got baptized in the Holy Ghost. I went to one of Brother Stacy, took me. He and Uncle Johnny Green were going to one of those things on a Saturday up there. I didn't know what it was, but Brother Stacy, he just got to be with me 6 years, six months, and he's still my pastor. I still call him my pastor. I've just always called him my pastor. And he's with me 6 months, and we went up there that day, and I saw these old women, man. They'd walk back when we was going from one place to the other, and they'd walk over to where the cafeteria is. And I'd see these dear old godly women. And they were the ones that looked like the women of old. And I don't want mine. I'm glad my wife looks like she looks. You know, I mean, I'm glad. But I haven't got anything against that. But that wasn't what I want to say. But when I got behind some of them people, Brother Eric, and them old ladies, and men, they'd be walking along, And they said, well, glory to God, hallelujah. And they was just walking, out there on the grounds, you know. Well, praise God, hallelujah. I said, they got something I ain't got. I come back on Sunday night after going up on Saturday. I got on the altar and I got filled with the Holy Ghost. I said, that was 6 weeks after I got saved. There was something. And if you ain't got that, you need that as well. You need to be baptized in the Holy Ghost. Yes, you do. Yes, you do. It'll bless you. It'll honor you. Jonah said he cried out of the belly of hell. Job, he couldn't find God on the right hand or the left hand or before him or behind him. He couldn't hear God. I'll just read it to you. He said in Job 23:8, behold, I go forward, but he's not there, and backward, and I cannot perceive him. On the left hand where he doeth work, but I cannot behold him. He hideth himself on the right hand, and I cannot see him. That's a bad shape to be in. We don't have to be in that shape today. All we do is say, Jesus. He's just a call away. Jesus, it's me again. I flubbed it up again, Lord. I stayed too long away from the Word. I stayed too long away from prayer, God. I talked in a wrong attitude to that brother or that sister the other day. I gave my opinion when it wasn't necessarily, and it may have been truth. You can do a lot of damage with the truth if it don't need to be spoken at the time. You can do a lot of damage with it. And I have to go back. God, it's me again. Like that old song, it's me again, Lord. Got a prayer that needs an answer. It's me again, Lord. Got a problem I can't solve. I don't mean to worry you, but here I am faced with something new. And I need help that only comes from you. It's me again, Lord. Let me just say this. And I'm not trying to curry anybody's favor, but it's good to hear them songs out of the old hymn. I believe there's some good contemporary music. Don't get me wrong. I believe there is. And I like a lot of it, too. But I tell you what, we don't want to ever let them old songs. We want to make sure. And it's not my place to be, I guess, giving advice. But those old songs, you compare them, you compare the verbiage and the worded in them, you'll find that it seems like those people that wrote those songs were living closer to God than some of these contemporary songs that we say today. Now, I believe there's some good ones. I believe there's some good ones. But so good to hear those old songs. Job looked on his right and his left, and he couldn't find him. Let me go to my fourth point. The fourth word I see in the word message is sage. Sage, I'll just give you the dictionary definitions. It means to know. It means wise and perceptive. It means based upon wisdom. It means showing judgment. The word sage is not in Scripture. At least I look in my concordance, and I don't believe it is if I didn't look over it. But many times you had some sages in Scripture, the wise man, the wise person that they would go to. They would go to this person, and those were sages. It means to know, to be wise and perceptive, based upon wisdom, showing judgment. The living, all-powerful, all-knowing Holy Ghost, or Holy Spirit, however you want it, means the same thing. In the message of life, what happens, it surfaces in our life. This is what happened when it surfaced in Job's life after he said verse 8 and 9 a while ago. I look on the right and left, backward and forward. I can't find him, but Job didn't quit. He said, but he knoweth in verse 10. He said, but he knoweth the way that I take. And when he hath tried me, I shall come forth as gold. He said in verse 11, my foot has held his steps. His way have I kept and not declined. Neither have I gone back from the commandments of his lips. I've esteemed the words of his mouth more than my necessary food. Can we get to where we esteem God's word? When we esteem God's word more than food, when we're willing to push it back a while, when we're willing to push back the plate and say, God, I esteem your word. I esteem what's written in this book, the Bible, more than my necessary food. That's when I've got some of the greatest breakthroughs that in my life is when I was willing to do some of those things. Now, it's not pleasant. We all like to eat. I know I'm kind of skinny. I used to weigh about 35 pounds more. And all in my gut, and so I decided I didn't want to do that no more. And so I lost it twice and then quit doing the very things that I had done to get it down. Then I'd get down to 160, then I'd go, well, you knew it, didn't Becca? Again, the third time, I said, oh, I've discovered. I've got to get it down there and keep doing the same things that got it down there to keep it down there. Now, I go anywhere from 152 to 155. Feel pretty good that way. Been that way for about 8 years. I'm glad that God looks down and teaches us some things. He tells us sometimes some of the things that we ain't got enough sense to think about ourselves. He tells us about it. What a great God he is. So let's look at that. This is the living, all-powerful Holy Spirit, the sage. Now, in old times, like I said, the word sage, I don't think is in the King James Version. That's what my concordance is. That's the kind of concordances I have. And so it's not in there. But there were things when they went to the wise man, that's what they were doing. They were the sages of Scripture. That's a part of the message of God, based upon wisdom, showing judgment, the living, all-powerful, all-knowing, omniscient, if I could use that word, omniscient Holy Spirit in the message of life. It begins to surface. And that's what happened there when I read verse 10 through 12, or I quoted verse 10 through 12 out of Job chapter 23. God won't leave you in life's mess. You may leave yourself there. You may decide that you want to have a pity party and just sit there. And I know none of y'all ever do that. But that just sit there and, well, if God don't do nothing, I guess I'll just sit here. God ain't going to do anything sometimes until we decide to do something. Until we decide to approach Him, take our situations before Him, and let God move in our situation. He won't leave you in life's mess. The wise, omniscient Holy Spirit won't leave you in life's mess. When your faith and your spirits begin to sag, He won't leave you there. He'll bring you out. He guides us. Our comforter, He teaches us. He shows us things to come. He comforts us. He knows us because He's the all-wise Holy Spirit. Has all wisdom. And through the omniscient Spirit, the all-knowing Spirit of God, wisdom above, takes over. Just takes over when we do that. He just comes in and He takes over and takes us from darkness to light. David, in his distress, the Bible said he encouraged himself in the Lord. Oh yeah, he encouraged himself in the Lord. When his buddies, even those men that had rode with him and fought for him, they came back to Ziklag. Ziklag was a town that had been given to him, I believe, by the Philistines. I need to go check. But while they were all gone out to battle, the Amalekites, they came some way. Some Bibles have it pronounced as Amalekites, and others have Amalekites. So I'll just do it either way. The Amalekites came in and took all. They just took all the women and the children and everything. They got back. Nobody were there. And so those men that had been riding with him turned on him. And you know, they always turn on the leader. It's always the pastor. They turn on the pastor. So they turned on him. And David, he didn't let that bother him. The Bible said that David, in his distress, he encouraged himself in the Lord. And he said, what shall I do, Lord? And he asked him, said, shall I recover? And God told him, said, go and you'll recover all. And David went and he got them all back. He went and he recovered it all, because he didn't quit when a situation called for quitting. He didn't get down in the dumps. He encouraged himself in the Lord. Can I tell you, if you get to that position, that is so discouraging, you just do the opposite of that. You say, I'm not into discourage today, devil. I'm into encourage, and I'm going to encourage myself in the Lord. And the last one, the last word I see in word message is age. That speaks of maturity. Coming of age. You know how usually the older people are the wiser ones. Have you noticed that? Because we've learned it the hard way. We've learned it at the school of hard knocks. Now, you younger people, you'll have to learn some of the school of hard knocks as well. That's the way it goes. But we've learned it. We learned it that way. God has a way of teaching us. He's a great teacher. Sometimes it's not all that pleasant. But maturity, that's why age speaks of. Coming of age, if you will. Although we never fully arrive in this life. We got to always remember that. We never arrive in this life. We never get to that place that we don't need more. We never get to that place that we don't need more wisdom, that we don't need help. Get us out of a situation. We keep maturing. Paul said that in Philippians chapter 3, verse 10, that I may know him and the power of his resurrection and the fellowship of his sufferings, being made conformable to his death, if by any means I might attain unto the resurrection. Brethren, I count not myself to have attained, neither. And then he goes on to say, I'm going to press toward the mark for the prize of the high calling of God, which is in Christ Jesus. The old folks used to say, children, it's a pressing way. Did you ever hear him say that? The old folks would say, children, it's a pressing way. Well, I say, children, this morning, it's a pressing way. God never told us it would be a party. He never told us it would be all fine and dandy. But I'll tell you what, I'd take 5 minutes of God's presence. I'd take 5 minutes of God's Holy Ghost having me just engulfed in his presence than all those other things I have to go through. Because like David, I will encourage myself in the Lord. I will get back to that thing that will bless me and bring me out of the money grubs. Sister Crockett, would you come this morning? And whoever else, I don't know how you do the altar calls. Each time the all-wise, all-knowing Holy Spirit, each time his wisdom lifts our sagging spirits, we come more of age. Every time we go back to him, we come a little more, we mature just a little bit more. I want to ask you this morning, if you stand to your feet. I want to ask you this morning a question or two. I'm going to ask you about two messages in one question. About the message of the Holy Ghost that spoke this morning, and also the message I've delivered. Can you say, this morning, the message has spoken to me? I know us Christians, I know we can say that. Can you say this morning, the message has spoken to me? I want to come to you this morning. And I've got a simple question. Is life better to you now, if you're somebody that was serving the Lord before, you don't feel like that you're in the fold right now? Is life better to you now than it was when you was in the fold? And you cannot answer that question truthfully if you don't say life was better when I was in the fold. You can't. That's the only way you can answer it truthfully. I want to ask you this morning, does your life seem like it's in a mess? Is your spirit sagging this morning? Just allow the all-wise Holy Spirit to comfort you, to mature you. He wants us to be bigger in spirit tomorrow than we are today. He wants us to know more. Remember that? That's one of the most songs. I want to know more about my Jesus. Yes, I do. I want to know more about my Lord. All you've got to do is simply allow the Holy Spirit to comfort you and mature you. Invite him to do it. Invite him to do it. The message of life. I'm talking about real life. I'm not talking about this air that I'm breathing life. I'm talking about real life. That begins with repentance. That begins